Hi everyone, and welcome to our channel. In this episode, which I call Export-Import, I'd like to go through a rather unique situation that I stumbled upon to be able to create interesting items using 3D components. Mostly components that you would find on the internet, but it certainly can be done with the components within the software. I don't know if I'm the only one who uses this technique, but I don't know many people that do. So let's go through the basic steps. We know how to import a 3D component from within the software. We go to the clip art page and either double click or drag the model, the clip art, onto our workspace. We can also click on the folder to import a 3D model. That opens up the window to orient our 3D model that we're trying to import. Here's an example of the Statue of Liberty that I found on the internet. Of course, we orient it correctly, whether it's the top, the right, the bottom, the left, the back, adjusted appropriately. Change the size. For those who have used the import functions before, this is a pretty common sight to see. For those of you who have never done this before, it takes a little practice to understand the alignment and the orientation that you'd like to have. The red wireframe that you see is your material. It shows now that the model of the Statue of Liberty is within my material, which is what I'm hoping for. That gray plane that you see in the center is considered a zero plane, but it's really not a zero plane as we know it. It just indicates what will be seen in your 3D view once you import it and what will be below or deleted if wanted. You could see the more brilliant color of the component will be shown as a 3D model, and below it, it's sort of grayed out. Again, you can adjust your component, your model, as need be to eliminate any excess Z heights. But that zero plane, that gray plane that we see in the window, is not in relationship to the wireframe of the material. It's more of a slicing plane. So when you have a 3D component like the Statue of Liberty, you can adjust it and create many, many different options. The front view, the side view, the back view. Here's a few examples of what I've come up with. I always envisioned myself creating a stamp for the Postal Service. This stamp was designed in VCarve. So a lot of things can be done with the software and the import of 3D components. So let's continue on. I call this thinking outside the box. Within your software, there's a clip art of a box. James Booth originally made this, and he took quite a bit of time to create it. It has four different parts, and I'll explode them to so you can see the different parts of the box. I took some basic measurements. The height of the box, I guess at the length of the box and the width of the box, and I created vectors that were similar in size and shape. And from those vectors, I created a simple flat component. And I added a bottom. So there's the box that I have. Unfortunately, it's as if I'm looking down into the box, and I need to adjust it so it looks more as if I'm looking at it from the side. So we take our component model, export it. Save it to a known location. Happens to be one of the big problems I have is I forget where I've put things. And then I re-import it. And again, as we've seen with the Statue of Liberty, that imported 3D model can be changed and manipulated, rotated, top, bottom, back, front, right. And now I just simply adjust it and rotate it to match the original box. I think my way was just a little quicker to come up with the same results. Let's take this a little further. Here's a basic sign that I found on the internet. I imported the picture into the software, drew the vectors for the component parts. I envisioned this to be more of a pressed tin sign from the 50s or 40s maybe. So everything is a little bit rounded. The font is simply the font. I traced some of it. I found a font online that sort of worked. The stars. The star components were simply a circular array. The lettering, the font, creating components from those vectors. The wrench I found online. So I'm adding the little details. Once I'm happy with that, I make a model from the components that are visible. Now comes the part for the tire. I create the vectors, the side view, the profile. I use the turn and spin. I create the little details for the rim. Of course, add some wording to make some fun of it. And that's the basic view of the tire, looking straight on at it. I'm going to take that, export it with an inverted front, so it winds up being a total tire, and I re-import it. I position it as need be. Of course, I have to watch the Z height of it, so I'm going to flatten it down slightly. Add some tread lines that could be V-carved and or as a component. And now it's ready to cut. One more time. These are using components from within the software. The Christmas tree. A little tip of the day here is that you can change the color of the components just for visual effects. Helps you realize what it may look like when it's finished, if you paint it that way. Little domed components to act as Christmas balls. And now I want to have some Christmas presents. I create a box, and I create the ribbon. The ribbon is simply a flat plane that's been set to merge, but raised above the box, so it looks as if it comes up the sides and across the top. The bow is simply vectors and component shapes, and suggests a ribbon. I export the box, and then I import the box, and rotate and position it as need be. You can adjust the base height of the component boxes. You can make oval boxes, different shapes of boxes, as many as you'd like. But there's still something missing. In our house, under the Christmas tree, there was usually a Christmas skirt. I didn't want to create anything new, because I was looking just to use the components within the software, and I found this little detail. Now, in my mind, I can see this being rotated and slipped under the tree. I export it, I import it, and place it there underneath the tree to act as a skirt. I can add extra shapes. A two-rail sweep gives the tree a little bit more body. I find a little flourish, a floral swag, that I can use as tinsel. Not too bad for using components within the software. Hopefully, you're getting the insight into what's happening here. And now for something completely different. I don't know how I came up with this. I do know where I was. I was on an airplane flying to one of the Vectric user group meetings, I think in Las Vegas. And sitting there flying across the United States, I thought, well, let's just see. So, here's the process. I create 3 cubes, 2 inches by 2 inches by 2 inches in thickness. That's the model. I export those, and I re-import them. I'm going to do this 3 times, 3 separate times, and I position them as appropriately needed. And if you lay it out correctly, you get what's called the Penrose Triangle, an optical illusion. And it's simply by exporting those boxes and re-importing them and positioning them correctly. So, things that make you go, you'd like to learn more about the software, subscribe to our channel, and don't forget to click on the bell to be reminded of our new videos. And of course, as always, if you need help, send me an email, mm@mezalick.com. I'll be glad to help. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Enjoy. We'll be right back.